And we know now that Discovery Channel, History Channel, and all sorts of mainstream things are co-opting a lot of this information. I was just in a bookstore again. I think it was Waterstones down in the basement. You should go there. And you should, you know, go there with objective eyes. And now you will see, you know, a lot of books debunking history, the lies of history, and so on. You know, again, co-opting a lot of what has been going on in the alternative movement. They're not doing the same work, and they're not, when they debunk a particular aspect of history, of course, they're weak. They're not really offering the true solutions. In fact, some of them are doing worse. They're offering one set of lies, you know, they're replacing one set of lies with another. But just the very fact that these kinds of books are now appearing shows you that there is a sea change taking place in the world. And therefore, even though that's all intriguing and everything, and it's infatuating, and there's more knowledge now than there ever has been before, and also the medium of gaining that knowledge is new. Now we have the internet, we have television, and all sorts of other electronic means of gathering incredible knowledge. But even though that is the case, one must never lose sight, at least in my work, because I never stopped talking about consciousness and the war on consciousness, is that basically everything that you hear today and during the weekend here is absolutely ultimately about yourself. Because whether you realize it or not, and maybe this is what, you know, should be your homework for the weekend, if you don't mind me saying that, and that is to contemplate deeply on the fact that everything that you hear of this kind of subject matter is testament to the fact that you are now on holy ground. Probably the only holy ground that exists, because that doesn't lie with the religions of the world. That's part of that matrix of control, to make sure that you just don't have an understanding of selfhood. This knowledge that immediately, if you call it occult, if you permit me to use that word, and all I mean is esoteric, it is occult because it is actually sacred. And it's sacred because it has to do with your selfhood. In the early stages, you don't know that. It's intriguing. It's read this, read that, you know, and pick up the sound bites and go from there. In the early stages, of course, one will not understand that. But the more mature person as they develop and they start asking these questions, and as they also start realizing how much they have to sacrifice in daily life to permit themselves to study this because of all of the backlashing and all of the resistance from family members and society. As you start to mature in the subject, you'll suddenly start to question, why am I even bothering with this? And it's at that point that maybe that voice will speak to you and say, but this is about your self-discovery. It's not just food for the mind, food for the brain. This is of paramount importance. Because in my work specifically, everything, the prime datum is consciousness. And if that doesn't change, then you may run around, you know, forever like the Keystone Cops trying to make political and social change, and it will never happen. And I think that's also one of the reasons why people can't do that. It's one of the reasons why we see this escapism, because walking the Siddhartha road of selfhood is probably one of the hardest things you could possibly do. You know, self-work or soul work. And also don't forget that if it is true what I'm saying, that ultimately, although you're not in a physical church or a physical shrine or a physical ashram, by studying this material, you with it, when you read the works of the great minds throughout the history of the world, you are now, whether you like it or not, on holy ground. That means, does it not, that you have to have a different sense of gratitude and reverence then. And that, again, is the dividing line between people who can't pull that off. They're not aware of it. And so they're reading the sacred knowledge and they're studying the sacred knowledge. But slowly, 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 the tests are going to come, and then they're not going to be able to go any further. Because to open the door on the Siddhartha road is the reverence. The reverence is the thing that unlocks the door. And if you don't have it, eventually you will not be able to go any further, which I've seen in my own life has happened with people. Because in this game, we don't need to be worrying about CCTV cameras and surveillance from, you know, Big Brother. We need to be worrying about a higher form of surveillance. The surveillance of one's own higher self. That's what we really need to be aware of. Not in some negative way, of course, but very conscious that this is a very living and real and vital thing that has to do with your real purpose on this planet, your dharma. And one should never lose sight of that. And maybe over the time when we're listening to the scholars here, we should always bear that in mind. Because remember, in ancient days, you know, Celtic mythology is full of it, so is most of the mythologies of the world. There were tests. There were trials. You know, read about King Arthur and any of the myths of the world. particularly the Celtic legends, they're full of it. But even today in various Eastern religions, in Taoism, right, Zen Buddhism, there's enormous tests and trials. And though we in the West today may not have to prove ourselves by walking over burning coals, you know, or fighting minotaurs and labyrinths or whatever you want to, way you want to look at it, there are still tests and trials, trials of will, a different order of tests and trials. And it won't take very long before we become familiar with what those are. And hopefully those will also be pointers that let you know that it's about selfhood. Why do you think it is, for instance, that the Freemasonic orders, and I include Knights Templars and Rosicrucians and all of these kinds of people, why do you think they have their hierarchies? Because they know exactly what I'm talking about. First, they have a certain tacit respect for history. That's one thing you must give them. They are preservers of ancient gnosis and knowledge. But the other one is that they understand that you just can't take the mugger off the street, you know, and just allow them access, you see, to sacred knowledge. And in one way, that's understandable. Of course, they take it too far, and they lose sight of the fact that all this knowledge is actually in the keeping of all humanity. It's not for an elect or, you know, specific group in that obvious way. But there's a price that comes with being a seeker after truth. From the emails that I get, from the communiques that I get, you know, of course you get a lot of different kinds of things, but I often notice that there's a great passion in the people, especially from the younger, and they wish that they could just completely dive into this material. You know, not even have to work and not have any of those worries. So that they could really jump in and absorb it, you know, and have nothing else going on in their lives except that. To be able to travel around, to be able to study endlessly. And that is incredible. But of course, the reality is that you can't. We have to have one foot in the world and one foot in that other holy place. And that is, again, a major struggle, as you well know. It's not too easy. And if I was to make this into a sermon, I would probably begin it by saying, you know, let's be grateful for what we're about to receive. But of course, I'll not do that on you. It's not a sermon. It's just a simple, actually, acknowledgement of, again, your own exceptionality in a way. And it's a way of me saying, you know, welcome to these things. Because I know that probably you know friends or even yourselves probably even decided, you know, oh, should I go, should I not? You know, the traffic, you know, the cost, or, you know, it's far away. I mean, did anybody feel that way? Was there anyone here who did actually have in two minds whether to even come? You would admit that? I mean, it's good. Let's admit this. If it was difficult, if those thoughts came up. But you made the choice. And that needs to be acknowledged and is a good thing. It's a very good thing. And I think the last thing I'll say before we move on, I won't take up too much of your time here, is that probably because of religion and just the entire matrix of confusion and lies and trickery that we've got in the world today, we probably do, in fact, have a very misgiven understanding of what is the self and what is the soul. So my parting words to you would be, you know, maybe we need to completely burn down, deconstruct all the ideas that we have about the soul. And my last point really will be that what happens, you know, we've been talking about knowledge being sort of the road to selfhood. What happens if the self and the soul is, as the psychologist Thomas Saz said, not something you find and not something that you've been given, but something that you create here in this world, now, in this life, through your experience? Now that gives a lot of pause, because what happens if that is the case? That you're not already born with what we call soul? Maybe that's lies, more deception.